So I have a story to tell you. It's the story of something that happened to me on one of our mission trips to West Virginia. Not recently, it was a long while back, but it has stuck with me ever since because it's a parable, really. It's my own little parable, and I decided that this Sunday, this first Sunday of Advent, was the right Sunday to share it. So here's the story. It was maybe a Wednesday on our week with the Appalachia Service Project, and the ASP staff at our work center told us that evening that they had a game for us to play. It's a challenge game, they said. Ah, I'll be good at this, I thought to myself. I mean, running games for kids is what I do all the time, so I was pumped. They let us outside, some 70 of us, teens and adults, and they took us to a small clearing surrounded by trees, and there were all these ropes running from tree to tree across the little clearing, forming an intricate pattern made out of what had to be hundreds of feet of rope woven in and out, and all tied together in like this web. It's a game, the staff said again. This is a maze that you have to find your way out of. So to start, everyone just go and grab hold of one of the ropes. So we did. All right, said the staff, we are just about ready. There are just a few key rules to tell you. First, you have to keep your eyes closed the entire time. Secondly, they said, you can't ever let go of the rope. Also, you can't speak to each other, but, they said, if you need to ask us anything, your friendly staff, just raise your hand and one of us will come and take your hand and you can whisper your question to us. It has to be a yes or no question. So, they said, close your eyes and start. So we did. Eyes tight closed, we all started shuffling our way along the ropes, searching for the path out of the maze. I was concentrating so hard. I really, really wanted to be the first person out of the maze. I knew it was like one of these logic puzzles somehow, and I knew there had to be some clever trick to it, and I wanted to be the one who figured it out. Time wore on. It was not going as well as I had hoped. Every rope I followed just led to knots and knots and more ropes, and I couldn't figure out what the deal was with this. And around me, I could hear people whispering questions to the staff, but I was not going to do that. I would show no weakness. Cindy knows me too well. So I kept shuffling along that rope with my eyes closed, and I was noticing something. I was sensing fewer and fewer people around me. It appeared that others were finding the way out. So, oh no, I was gonna look stupid. I hate looking stupid. My hands, still clutching that rope, were sweating with anxiety. And this voice whispered in my ear, "Do you need help?" No, I said. Quite mortified and made the object of someone's pity. "I can figure this out," I said, and I kept plodding along. And after a time, another voice whispered in my ear, a different voice, "You should really ask for help." Okay, I said. So eyes still closed, I raised my hand, and a staffer took my hand so I could ask my question. "Am I going the right direction?" I whispered. "No." Well, that was a big help. So I just stood there, tears of frustration seeping from my closed eyes. I could feel no other hands pulling on the ropes anymore. I knew I must be alone on the maze. And I stood there a long time with my head down, furious at myself for failing, and confused and embarrassed. "Ask for help," whispered someone. Finally raised my hand, and again someone took it. "Would you please help me?" I asked. "Yes, She said, "That's all you needed to ask. That's the way out of the maze. Open your eyes." So I opened my eyes. Of the 70 people who had started, I and one other person were the only ones still clutching the rope. All that time, all I had needed to do was to ask for help. The way that anyone got out of that maze had nothing to do with figuring out the darn ropes and knots. All anyone had to do to get out of that tangled mess was to humble themselves and say the words, "Would you help me?" 68 other people had been able to do that before me and my stubborn pride. So I tell this story, this maze story, because here's what I think. I think this is actually an Advent story. It's an Advent parable. And now you're like, what? What does this story have to do with getting ready for Christmas? Because that's what Advent is, right? Advent is when we get ready for Christmas. We buy the gifts, we decorate the tree, we string the lights, we make the cookies. All true. All true. But Advent is about some inner work, too, some spirit work. Advent also means getting our hearts ready for Christmas, getting our souls ready for Jesus' arrival. And the way we do that work is by taking a deep breath and admitting we need help. Advent is when we swallow our pride, raise our hands, and ask for help. What we're doing in Advent, one by one and all together, is admitting that we need some assistance, admitting that the end of the maze is beyond our own reach, admitting that we need someone to take our hand and show us the way. Advent is when all humanity says to God, "Help. We humans really can't do this on our own. We need a Savior. We need God to be with us. We need God with us. We need Emmanuel. We need someone to show us the way, someone to bring us healing." Advent is all of us taking a deep breath, raising our hands, and saying, "Hey, could you use some help here?" The scripture that Seth just read to you is the scripture that always pops up in the church lectionary this time of year. That's the recommended Bible readings for pastors and churches. So all this next week, people in churches all over will be hearing the story of this guy, John the Baptist. He was Jesus' cousin and kind of his advance man. And John's role was simply to go around saying to people, "Hey, you need help. You need a Savior." And guess what? The good news is that he's coming. Help is on the way. That's what Advent says to us. Hey, guess what? He's coming. Help is on the way. The hard part is asking for it. The hardest part about Advent is not untangling all those Christmas lights that you balled up and threw in a paper bag last January. The real challenge of Advent is getting your heart untangled, getting your spirit ready, really ready, by being willing to ask for help. Look at me in that darn maze. All I had to do was raise my hand and ask for help, and I couldn't do it. There's a pastor out in Colorado that I've mentioned to you before, a Lutheran woman pastor named Nadia Boltz-Weber. And her church, I love this, her church is known as the Church for All Sinners and Saints. And she makes sure that everyone knows that they're welcome there. And the reason for that is that her own journey to church, her journey to God, started not in the pews, not in a church sanctuary, but in a church basement, which is where the AA meetings were held. And she stumbled, almost literally stumbled, into one of those meetings. And that's where she learned to ask for help. She had gone to that meeting because a friend had told her that she was an alcoholic, and Nadia just wanted to prove her wrong. So she sat there at the meeting on an old sofa in the corner of that church basement, looking for some affirmation that she really wasn't supposed to be there. Instead, she discovered that she probably was in the right place, and she kept going back. The only thing that rubbed her the wrong way was everyone kept talking about God so much, and Nadia really hated Christianity because she had grown up with a God who was always disappointed in her, always judging her, and she really didn't see what that God was going to do for her. And then one day, one of her AA friends said to her, "Stop thinking about it so much, Nadia. When you get up in the morning, just ask God to help keep you sober, and when you go to bed at night, thank Him." So she did. She tried asking for help. She asked God for help. And she said, what it felt like was that I had been on this path towards self-destruction, and God reached down, grabbed me by the scruff of my collar, and plunked me down on an entirely different path. It wasn't a matter of her will, she says. It was God giving her her life back. Because, with great reluctance, she finally asked for help. That may not be your story. The help that Nadia needed may not be the help that you need, or maybe it is. But regardless, the truth is that all of us need help with something. There is something that we could do better. There is maybe faith that could be stronger, or kindness, or hope. Maybe there's forgiveness that we've been struggling with, or patience that seems to elude us. Maybe we could just be doing more, or doing better. There's something that each of us needs help with. We have a little over 3 weeks until we gather here to celebrate Christmas. 4 Sundays together, and then a burst of candles and Christmas trees and carols and joy. So by all means, use these 3 weeks to be joyful, to delight in this season, to celebrate and rejoice. But try this too. Use these weeks to think about your needs, your deepest desires, your own longing for healing. Use the time ahead to ask for help. Prayerfully, earnestly, open, honestly, raise your hand and ask for help. Because it's on the way. It's on the way. The angels are tuning their harps. Shepherds are heading for the hillside with their sheep, and a young, weary couple is beginning their walk toward Bethlehem. Help is on the way. He is on the way. Just